Hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. We're gonna begin the presentation here in just a few minutes to give to everybody a chance to join here. In the meantime, please feel free to enjoy this short video about CI.
All of us wake up every day and make a choice. Option A is to coast. Take it easy. Sip coffee as you watch the clock. Sure, you won't get much done, but it'll be a walk in the park. Option B, work. Make a difference today. Make things with integrity. Head home with sweat on your back and pride in your soul. If you are the option B type, we have three words for you. Welcome to Cincinnati. We work hard, and we're proud of what we produce, just like you. We've been here since the 19th century. Our fathers and grandfathers built machines that last generations. Their strong work ethic and philosophy was passed down to us. Today, we make the equipment that bends, cuts, and prints your parts. When you own a Cincinnati, you don't just own the machine. You own the integrity of CI. You own our expertise. And you own all the glorious results that come from your hard work. That's what kept us cranking out quality and innovation for over 120 years. It's a two-for-one deal around here. Buy a Cincinnati machine. We throw in that mindset, free of charge. Roll up your sleeves and get your hands dirty. It's time to work. Own it.
All right. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Happy Thursday, everybody, and welcome to Understanding Press Break Deflection Compensation. My name is Nikki, and I'm the marketing specialist here at CI, and I'll be your moderator for today. Our presenter, Todd Kirchhoff, he's going to join us here in a few minutes, is the product manager of Vertical Motion Products. Todd's got over 30 years of experience in the metal fabrication industry. He served as a sales engineer and product application specialist, helping people such as yourself improve bending features or bending results through techniques such as the ones he's going to present here in just a few short minutes. Well, before we begin, let's do a little housekeeping. Over to the left, you should see a control panel that's similar to what you guys have. You don't have to worry about any background noise because we're going to keep you muted for the presentation. However, down below here, you'll see a question area, and that's where we encourage you to ask as many questions as you like throughout the presentation. We have reserved a few minutes at the end to answer as many as we can get to. Over here on the right side, it should look a little similar to what you have. Unfortunately, we don't have a webcam for this presentation, but you're able to increase and decrease the slide deck as much as you feel comfortable with by grabbing either one of these corners, also using the minimize and maximize buttons up here at the top right. We do want to let you know that the session is being recorded and you will be sent a link after the presentation. Also, at the end of the presentation, there's just a short exit survey that just gauges your experience for this presentation, if there's any ways we can help improve it, as well as if there's any future topics you'd like for us to maybe talk about. With that, I'm going to hop on over to our website. Here is the events section of our website. It's www.e-ci.com/events. This is where you can stay on top of all of our events that we're hosting throughout the year, everything from webinars to trade shows to open houses. And speaking of open houses, if we have anybody in our North Carolina, Charlotte area, we do have an open house happening on March 26th at our very new partner, Hendrick Motorsports' facility. If you join us there, you can see our new machines being demonstrated in their facility. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and change the presenter over to Todd.
So I too like to thank everybody for joining us today and to talk about press break deflection compensation. So as Nikki had introduced me, my name is Todd, and I currently the manager of Vertical Motion Products here at Cincinnati, and also manage our press break applications group. So this is a topic that I've kind of learned over the years is a frequently misunderstood area of press break. So, you know, hopefully we've tapped into something here that's useful for everyone. And we got a lot of attendees, so it looks like there is a good amount of interest. So what I plan to do is to talk about, you know, the applications where deflection in a press break, what it does, how you need to compensate for it, what types of systems are available to compensate for the deflection in the machine. So with that, I'll launch in. And really, press break work, to me, I can kind of relate it to fishing, something I enjoy to do both cases. But, you know, someone might ask, hey, is fishing hard? Well, fishing is not hard. It's catching fish. That is the difficult part, and can relate to press breaks the same way. Is making a press break go up and down difficult? No, it's not. It's making good quality parts that is the challenge and the difficulty. So hopefully this topic will help that experience for you go a little bit easier and smoother, give you some more insight. And, you know, really on press breaks, I think the industry does a good job of helping operators with the basics. Certainly press break safety is a topic that we cover here at Cincinnati in our training classes that our customers attend. Whether you come to a formal class or you're taught at your own company or just taught from an experienced person in your group, tool selection certainly is important, and knowing what size V-dies to use, which material is often taught well, and then how to, you know, use your machine to make adjustments to the bend angle and the flange when things don't turn out the first time. But what we tend to find is that is all well, and then what about long parts? That tends to be a whole nother area. So if you look at something like this on your cart, the job that's coming down the line to you, and if you know, have received a lot of the training and dealt with small parts, and you may be prone to say, hey, I need a little help here on understanding what to do. There's more kind of another layer of complexity that comes about when you bend something that's a little bit longer, such as you would see here. And even though this is a 16 gauge or maybe an 18 gauge part that's, you know, 8, 9, 10 feet long, what have you, introduces some more challenges. And you may need a little more insight as to how to get good results from that. So what do we typically do when you get into a bind? And you know, most companies have old Joe, who's still around. He's been with the company for years. He knows the press breaks in and out. And we go to him and say, hey, I need a little help. You know, what ideas can you give me? Well, you know, I'll tell you what we know is that the press breaks, as they look in the shiny marketing materials and websites, they don't look like that for very long after the machines are put into production. So something like this is not that uncommon. So you may be instructed, hey, let's look at the bed and ram, see if we have any worn areas. You look at this picture and you can even see the indentation of a die set that was overloaded and left mark that might be a thousandth or two deep on the machine, who knows, rust spots that cause issues. But that's just in the bed or on the ram or maybe the die holder. He may also say, let's look at the tooling. You know, what condition are your tools in? Because that's not going to help you make good parts if we have worn tools. He may also instruct you, let's look at die alignment and make sure that the V-die and the punch are aligned correctly. So there's things that he's going to start with the basics to point you to and to make sure that you've looked those over. But what else may affect us when we're bending the long part and we're getting an angular variation along the bend on something that's a little bit longer? So really, what do we want an operator to know when he's trying to do something like this? What other factors may be causing him issues? So that's kind of what we're going to be getting into. And with that, I think I'm going to launch into turn it back to Nikki quickly, and she is going to kind of ask a polling question to get you engaged in the webinar.
Okay, so our first polling question, let's launch this. How did you learn to run a press break? Was it self-taught, a coworker, in-house program, or formal training class? So the results for how did you learn to run a press break? So 31% said self-taught, 48% of you said a coworker, 8% of you said in-house program, and 13% of you said formal training class. So I'm gonna go ahead and hide those results.
Okay, that's very interesting. So I guess everyone's got an old Joe at their place who was kind of your mentor to help you out. So that's not uncommon. Wish there was more people who would take advantage of formal training. If you'd like some more training, we can help with that, but that might give you a little more in-depth insight and background. So if we can help you with there, let us know. And then I also find it interesting that about a third of you were self-taught. So I applaud you for that. It's not an easy operation to learn on your own. So well done there for that group. So let me continue on. We were talking about, you know, what else do we need to consider when we are bending a long part? And that's what introduces the topic of deflection. And we'll show some examples here in a break. But we all of us have some common examples of deflection, and we don't really stop to think how this might occur on a press break. But the simple examples that I show here is, you know, the person on the top, they're walking on a tightrope, you know, that certainly deflects. And then something maybe more of us are used to if we're remodeling a house or building a deck in the backyard or something, we're dealing with deflections of support beams, as you see here. So no, if we put a load on a beam, there's going to be a certain amount of deflection that takes place. So if we, in that more common example that we can relate to of a beam, press brakes are essentially made up of a upper and a lower beam, the ram and the bed. So the thing that's interesting is that the press brake designer who decides how thick and tall to make those structural members of the machine, they're trying to make the machine as versatile to run as possible, but also to resist deflection as much as is reasonable. So if you, for example, are using back to the, the kind of a lumber explanation here of a beam, if you had a 2x4, that you were going to build something with, if you went with a 2x8 that's much deeper, you get quite a bit more strength in that. In fact, if you doubled that from a single 2x4 to 2x8, you really get about 8 times more strength and ability to resist deflection. If you went thicker with a 4x4, you would not have nearly as much strength, and on a press break, it wouldn't be a good idea if your bed gets too wide. It can create some problems. So deflection is something that is inherent in the machine. We try to minimize that the best that we can. And the reality is it does show up at times into the part. So let's get more deep into that. So this next picture here gives you an idea of how the machine might be reacting to a load exerted onto that. Now, certainly this is an exaggerated example. You wouldn't possibly buy a press brake that was this flimsy, but the type of the material that's selected and the structural size of the members and have you is what we're trying to deal with here. And the amount of load, the length of the part, etc., will make this deflection more or less. So what happens? We want to talk about what happens on the part. So in this picture is an example of a part that might come off of a press brake, and we call this the canoe effect. So this is a long part. Those of you that have dealt with this know typically what's going to happen. You're going to get more open bend to create this canoe shape in the middle, and you may be more closed on the end, and that's because of that structural beam is going to bow more in the middle of the machine. So that's what we're trying to deal with, really. But as I mentioned at the start of the webinar, there's a lot of misconceptions as to when this is going to be a problem for me and what do I need to do to compensate for that. So let's look at a couple of kind of extreme examples here. And it's somewhat counterintuitive in that what a lot of people think is if I have a large machine and I'm bending heavy material, that is obviously a pretty high load on the machine, and therefore I'm going to get a lot of deflection in the machine. So it's kind of what you see on the left here. This operator is bending something that might be 3/4 or 1 inch thick, but it's not a very long part. Now, contrast that to the picture on the right, where we've got a light gauge material with a very small V die, a very long part. And the point of this comparison here of these two parts is that you might find that you have more difficulty here achieving the results on this small, thin, long part than you do on the great big heavy part. And there's a couple reasons for that. That's what I'm going to get into. So to really kind of understand that, what we need to talk about is what I call the V opening versus the sensitivity. And I want to teach you a basic rule of thumb that might help an operator along, and that is if you can remember a baseline of a 1-inch V opening. So we'll start with a 1-inch V. And you would normally use a 1-inch V for something like 11-gauge material, okay? But a 1-inch V is easy to remember. So the sensitivity of a 1-inch V is you have to have an error somewhere of about 5/1000ths of an inch to equate to 1 degree error in the part. So if you're bending a very, very small part, you're not using some of the smarter controls, which would calculate automatically, you know, how deep to penetrate into the V die for you. And, you know, this is what we would call position mode. So if you were bending a part and you were a couple of degrees off when you were bending 11 gauge material over a 1-inch V opening, then this rule of thumb will kind of help you adjust the machine to get you back in the ballpark to make the angle you want. So if you were a couple degrees off, you might make an adjustment in the ram reversal position of 10/1000ths of an inch. So the baseline to kind of keep in the corner of your mind there to remember is that for a 1-inch V opening, the sensitivity of the die is approximately 5/1000ths of an inch per degree. Now, that 5/1000ths of an inch can show up not only in a ram adjustment, but it could also show up in maybe an airs, a beat up tool, picture that I showed of the worn bed. So anywhere where you've got a difference of 5/1000ths of an inch of penetration into that 1-inch V, you can see approximately 1 degree of difference. So kind of put that in the back of your mind. And then the next thing I would show is that this is a linear relationship with other V openings. So let's go smaller than the 1-inch V. Let's cut that in half. And if we were bending 16-gauge material, most likely we would use approximately a 1/2-inch V opening. So we have to be a half of 1-inch. So now, instead of a 5/1000ths per degree sensitivity, now we're dealing with half of that, about 2.5/1000ths. Of a degree. And so now we're getting to be a pretty small number very small differences in tool heights or bed and ram condition or other things that can kind of compound themselves down the length of a machine in either to create the canoe effect in the part or maybe even some irregularities in the bend. So we started with a 1-inch V at 5,000ths per degree. It's a linear relationship. If you have a smaller V, then it's going to be more sensitive and only can get away with 2.5 thousandths before you see a degree difference. So now let's swing the other direction, and that is we go larger. So larger dies, larger V openings are more forgiving. So now, if we had twice the V opening size to bend quarter inch material, we would have maybe a 10 thousandths of an inch per degree. So this is where some of the misconceptions come from, is if you think that I'm bending thicker material, so therefore I'm putting more load on the machine, it's going to deflect more. But what comes back the other direction is your dies are more forgiving, and that amount of deflection that you're seeing may not equate to the same amount of degree of error in your part. So keep that in mind as we're talking about the effects of deflection. So this is something that really kind of helped me understand what was going on press breaks, and especially those of you that have only been running machines for a few years and maybe have the luxury of having a nice newer machine with an advanced control that does a lot of the calculations and reversal position calculations automatically for you, or even the crowning values. Keep this in mind. So with that, what are some different deflection compensation methods that are used out there if we're bending a part and we're not getting the good results that we want? What methods are there? Well, there's certainly kind of an old school method here, and it takes a lot of experience to know how to do this, but you can certainly put manual shims in the middle of your tool. It's easiest to put them underneath the lower die. So in this case, this operator got a large screwdriver. He pried the die up out of the die holder. Can't really see it well in the picture, but there's a little piece of shim stock that he's getting ready to slip in there under the tool. And again, how much? Well, you remember that rule of thumb, it depends on what you're bending. This die looks like it's about an inch V opening. So if you're seeing a canoe effect where you've got about a degree open in the middle versus the ends, you might start with a 5,000 shim. So you get the idea that this is pretty difficult to do quickly, but it's even more difficult to repeat this type of a setup. And that's really the key. You may be experienced and you can get this right with some trial and error, but to duplicate this setup down the road is a challenge. And we're talking, feeler gauge thickness of shims here. And, you pull out a feeler gauge set and realize that a couple thousandths thick feeler gauge, that's a pretty thin piece of material that you're trying to slide underneath there and get the right amount of shims. So a very common method, not something that we would really promote doing in today's age with today's machines, but nevertheless, this is how you go about it. And those charts that I showed previously give you an idea of maybe how much shim stock you would want to put underneath the die. But again, lots of experience required to do this, and someone better have a pretty good three-ring binder stashed away somewhere with some good notes so this could be repeated on a job. Now, there are other deflection compensation methods beyond prying a tool up and throwing some shim stock underneath the tools. So one area or one method that's used with some builders is that you can take your machine when it's new and you can pre-machine a crown into the bed and or the ram and create a crown so that when you apply a load to that, to some degree, it will start to flatten that crown out. And the question is, how much crown would I want in a machine to get good results? And the answer to that is, you can only put a one amount of crown in a machine at a time if you're machining it into the bed and ram. So you kind of have to pick a middle of the road value. Machine builders can do that. Machines come standard in this way. But let's look at some graphs here to try to get a better understanding as to how much crown and how much what results we would see from this type of a deflection compensation method on a machine. I'll give you a second to kind of absorb this graph. This is next few slides are kind of the more detailed of the presentation, but what I'm showing here is if you had a machine that did not have any crown machine into it, did not have any other type of a deflection compensation system or method on it, you just have a flatbed and ram. So in this example, let's say we had 135 ton, 10 foot length machine, a very common size machine out in the industry. And if we were bending different material thicknesses of different bend lengths, what would the results look like? So where I will get you oriented is if you look on the x-axis, number four, that's a 4 foot long bend. The different color lines there are 18 gauge, 11 gauge, and quarter inch. Now remember, we're using different V openings to bend these different thickness materials. So the sensitivity of the die plays into the results here. So the first thing you might realize looking at this is that we really only start to see an issue in the differences of the bend angle along the length of the part. That's what that's showing in the y-axis. We only start to see an area you might think we need to do something about it at about the 4 foot mark. Because at 4 foot mark, we're at about a half degree variation down the length of the part. Most of the prints that I see, for whatever reason, they're spec'd out at plus or minus a half degree. And a lot of people say we can live without results, plus or minus a half down the length of a part. Okay, so in this case, as you get into longer pieces than 4 feet, you start to see the variation grow. And it's kind of interesting that even though there's a flatbed and ram, they all follow each other pretty closely to where you're at about the 2 to 2.5 degrees of variation from the center to the ends of the part on an 8 foot bend. Okay, so all of them kind of react the same way. And again, I'll keep reinforcing, why is that? Because different V dies have different sensitivity. So even though the thicker material might generate more tonnage and more load on the machine, the fact that the V die is larger, it's less sensitive to the deflection. So the results, interestingly enough, come out to be pretty bunched together. But if you're bending 8 foot parts on this machine, you may not be happy with a 2 to 2.5 degree variation on that part when you're doing your longer parts. So what is an example of a deflection compensation method? And we were talking about having a pre-machined crown into the bed and or the ram. And what would happen if we did that? So these lines would show you the results again for 18 gauge, 11 gauge, and quarter inch. So what this is showing is you have a very flat line in the 11 gauge material. So the amount of crown that's put into this particular machine really was optimized for that 11 gauge range of load on the machine. You'll see on the quarter inch material, even though you know it's more load, it flattens out that crown, not quite to the optimum amount, but we should be at about a degree from the center to the ends. And quarter inch, some people might be okay with that, some of you might not. But look what happens on the blue line with the 18 gauge. It starts going the other direction, and it starts going the other direction pretty quickly as we get into decent length parts. So what this is showing is this pre-machined crown into the bed and the ram. Although it's good for some material, ranged materials, it's not so good for others. So if you're bending really light, thin parts with very small V-dies, and you've got a pre-machined crown in your bed, then you're going to get some poor results in your finished part, and it's going the wrong direction. Instead of a canoe, it's the opposite shape of that. So that's the pros and cons of having a pre-machined crown into the bed. You kind of have to ask yourself, what range of material thicknesses do I plan on using, and what length will I be bending on those different material thicknesses? So let's now look at kind of the same deflection compensation method of having the machine crown, but let's look at a different size machine. So let's switch over and look at a large tonnage machine, a 500 ton machine that's 14 feet long overall length, and looking at those three different materials again, this time we're looking at 18 gauge, but then because it's a 500 ton machine, we're looking at larger, thicker materials, also 3/8 and 3/4. So you kind of see a similar curve when the bed and ram are flat that we showed you on the 135 ton. But you are about on a 12 foot bend, you're approaching a 2 degree variation difference. Your best result actually is in the 3/4 because we're more optimized for that amount of load and V opening. So even though you get maybe decent results, they're not optimum results. And you may have to do some sort of a shimming or other type of deflection compensation on this size machine. So now let's look at that same size machine, if it had a crowned bed or ram and or ram on the machine. So in this case, kind of similar to what we had before, we see that the results start going the wrong direction for the thin material. But they're going in the wrong direction at a much faster pace. So now we're bending the 12-foot part of 18 gauge on a 500-ton machine, and that machine has a pre-machined crown. We could see as much as a 10-degree difference from the center to the ends. Certainly not acceptable. So this is a challenge, really, when a press brake user wants to do a huge range of materials on one machine. I understand why. You have to make good use of your assets, but the machine that's good for 3/4 may not be good for 18 gauge without doing some other corrections on that. All right. So those charts are an example of a pre-machined crown into the bed or the ram. So it's a fixed static crown, and depending on the material, the openings, lengths, gives you an idea of the results that you might expect. All right, so now let's talk about another deflection compensation system or method. So in this picture, instead of having a pre-machined crown, what we're showing is a crowning cylinder, a hydraulic cylinder. The picture on the left is looking at the back of the machine. So if you look into the center, you can see the hydraulic cylinder protruding out in the rear of the machine. And then the picture on the right is orientation showing you the front. So what's happening here, how this device works, how it's constructed, is you have on the front and on the back side of the bed what are called deflection plates. And those deflection plates are attached with some pins. These are pretty large diameter pins you see in that picture. These might be 6-inch diameter or so. And the hydraulic cylinder then is inserted. There's a slot that's machined into the deflection plates and into the bed itself. And that hydraulic cylinder, which is a very short, shallow cylinder, is inserted. So during the bend, the crowning occurs dynamically while you're bending. So this system, when you are generating tonnage load on the machine, because the oil is displaced from the upper cylinders, it's plumbed down into this hydraulic cylinder in the bed, and you always get a proportional amount of force pushing back up on the bed, so to resist that natural deflection that's going to occur. So that's how that device would work. And now let's kind of talk about some of the results that we might get if we use that type of a system. So let's go back to a couple of chart comparisons again. So the thing to note here with a hydraulic crowning system, you do have the ability to turn that off. There's a valve on the side of the machine that is plumbed right to the hydraulic crowning cylinder, and it can be turned in the off position. So if it's either inadvertently off or, you know, intentionally turned off, what results would you get? This is the identical chart, 135 ton, 10 foot machine that I just showed you before, if you had a flat bed and ram, because the bed and the ram are naturally flat. There's no crown machined into it, and if that cylinder is off, there's no deflection compensation occurring. You're going to get exactly the same results, which, if you remember, was in that 2 to 2.5 degree range on an 8 foot part, but really didn't see a whole lot of issues until I got to a part that was really greater than 4 feet in length. Okay, so these three lines are 18 gauge, 11 gauge, and 1/4 inch. So if it's off, you got a flat bed and ram, you get pretty consistent results, but as you get longer, they may be out of tolerance for you. So what if that system was turned on? Well, the bottom line here is that when the system is turned on, we're going to get better results across a range of parts. So now, because we're dynamically pushing up on the bed during the bend, depending on how much load is being generated, our 18 gauge, our 11 gauge, and our 1/4 inch is pretty consistent, pretty flat results everywhere from a 2 foot long part all the way up to an 8 foot long part. So in this case, you know, assuming we have good quality tools and no other variables we've introduced into the bending process, you know, we're at about a half degree variation from the center out to the ends with this system turned on. And probably what I didn't stress before, just so we're on the same page, this is when you're air bending, and this presentation is not to get into depth into the different bending techniques, but the point here is air bending is we have tools that are cut to an acute angle so that the material is not bottoming out in any way in the bottom of the die. So we might have a 75 degree tool to bend a 90 degree bend, and we know we're not going to hit bottom. So all these charts are based on air bending results. But you see here with the hydraulic system on, we've really achieved pretty good results across the board. So the advantage of this type of a system is that it's just on. I don't have to know how much to program. I don't have, as an operator, have to understand that die sensitivity. As long as I'm using good quality tools and following standard practice bending rules of what the opening size I'm using for different materials, then I'm going to get very consistent results across the board here. So that's a big advantage from an operator standpoint, to not have to put a lot of extra thought how he's going to achieve that. Okay. Now, I'll switch gears here to a different type of a crowning, a deflection compensation system. Some of you may be familiar with this, but this is what I would call a mechanical wedge type of a system. And how this works is that you see the picture here on the left of the die holder, but you don't see any hydraulic cylinder built into the bed. So how do I create some sort of crown or deflection compensation in that die holder? And that's where the picture on the bottom right shows you what's inside of that die holder. And there are two we call wedge plates, sitting on top of each other. And what happens is you move those plates relative to each other, and you can see that the those waves are closer together in the center than they are on the ends. So when I move one of those plates relative to the other, I create a vertical displacement that's greater in the center than it is on the ends. Now, how this is different than the hydraulic cylinder that I showed just a minute ago is that this occurs not dynamically, this occurs prior to the stroke. There's two versions of this. There's a manually adjusted version, which just has a hand crank on the end of the unit. And then there's also a version that replaces that hand crank with a CNC drive motor. They both move the wedge the same way, and they both are intended to move prior to the stroke. So you do not want these wedges trying to move relative to each other during the stroke when you have load exerted. They need to be holding their position and holding in place. So there are different names for these types of systems, everything from CNC crowning to crownable die holders, crownable filler blocks. But this is what they're referring to as this mechanical wedge type of a crowning or deflection compensation system here. Okay. Now, thing that kind of the pros and cons of this system is that you may be asking yourself, how do I know how much adjustment I need to make to those wedges to get good results? And the first answer is, if you have a hand crank version, there will be a dial indicator to show you how far you've moved it, what setting you are at, and you would have to, through trial and error, remember that number for different jobs and record that somehow. Either record it in a routing sheet, a log sheet, a setup sheet on paper, or if you have a control that does provide a notepad area to enter, you need to put that number in there. So, you know, the hand crank is fast to achieve the result, but it's, again, unless you've taken good notes, it's not very repeatable. The other thing, if you have a manual version of this, and if you are bending maybe a rectangular panel, then you might want different crown settings if you're bending the short versus the long length of the part. And that would require you putting the part down and walking over and turning the hand crank between each step to reset it to the desired amount. So that's one of the downsides of having the manual hand crank version. So a CNC version of that is certainly, shows its value if that needs to move between steps, because the drive motor and control can drive the motor and change it. Although it will not allow the machine to stroke until the wedges have completed their move and they're set in the position they need to be in. Now, I'll switch to really an advantage of the CNC version of this, in that the machine will give you some help as to what setting that you need to set that crowning device at. So these two wedges are going to move. So a snapshot here on the top left of the control screen, what this shows you is that because in your program you have told the control what material thickness you're bending, what V-opening that you are using, and what bend length you're bending, it will calculate a tonnage value that it believes it will take to bend that part and the amount of crown that the system believes that you should start with to get a straight bend across the length of the part. So if you look in the top left, you see the computed crown value of 10 thousandths of an inch based on those parameters I just described to you, the length of a part you've told it to be opening, material thickness, and that tonnage it calculated. You can accept that value and give that your first bend try, or you can override that value to a smaller or larger number, and this is now programmed per step, in your part program. So as many steps as you have on that program, you can have a different crown value for each of those 10 steps programmed and saved as part of your program. So that's kind of the pros and cons of the mechanical wedge type system, as I call that. Okay. So a question that I get asked pretty commonly, someone who is using a mechanical wedge type crowning device, deflection compensation device, is, you know, I have to really make two types of corrections. I have to get the bend angle correct, and I have to get the bend angle consistent down the length of the part. So my suggestion typically is to get your crown adjusted first so that the part, the angle of the part, is consistent down the length of the bend. And if it's, 2 degrees open, but it's 2 degrees open down the entire length of the part, that would be where I would start, and then go into the control and ask for an angle correction. Or if you're manually selecting values in the machine, then you can type in a different RAM penetration value of your choice. But I would start with adjusting the crown first and then move to the final desired bend angle after that. So I know I've been talking for a while, Nikki, so I hope you're still with me. So I'm going to turn it over to you for our second polling question.
Okay, sounds good. Let me launch it here. All right, which deflection compensation method do you use most? Absolutely none. Manual shims, hydraulic cylinders, a wedge or die holder? I'll give you guys a few seconds to answer. I feel like there should be music playing while this happens.
Yeah, exactly. Hopefully we still have some people on the other end. I didn't put everyone out.
No. All right. It'd
be interesting to see what the results are of this question, because there are a variety of systems out there. And curious kind of what's in play.
All right. Looks like the majority have answered. So I'm going to go ahead and close it.
All right, share those answers with us, Nikki. I'm gonna.
You got it. Okay, so for which deflection compensation method do you use most? 18% of you said none. 31% of you said manual shims. 33% of you said hydraulic cylinders. And 18% of you said wedge die holder.
Okay, very interesting. Yeah, so looking at those results, the manual shimming method is almost a third of you, so there's opportunity there to help those of you improve your productivity with maybe adding something to your machines if desired. Hydraulic cylinders, about a third as well, and that's not surprising. Those are very straightforward from an operator standpoint, simple system, and again, if you are following along with traditional bending rules of V-openings and the like, you get really good consistent results across the board. That's kind of the real, you know, advantage of that type of a system. Maybe there's a disadvantage of that system is if you are cheating, maybe making or using a really small V opening for the material thickness, you might find that hydraulic cylinder doesn't give quite enough. You know, you want a little more oomph out of it, but you can't get it out of that. A wedge system at least gives you the ability to program how much crown you want, but there's a pros and cons to everything. The downside of that is it's a little more trial and error to get the results if you have to up the mechanical wedge crowning. But gives you an idea. There's a lot of choices out there. You can get to the same results with different systems, just a matter of which ones you're comfortable with and which ones you can get there the quickest and most repeatable. So from there, I get asked a lot, well, you know, there's a number of you here that are either not doing any shimming and living with the results, or you're putting shim stocks or paper or whatever you're putting under your dies to to build up that deflection compensation. So what if I wanted to add something to an existing machine? Can we do that? And absolutely, you're not going to add a hydraulic cylinder easily to your machine. That's you would need a different bed. You would need the cylinder. You would need all the plumbing. You would need the two deflection plates. And it's not going to be cost effective for you to try to add something like that to an existing machine. So the easier solution there would be to put the mechanical wedge version, because that's part of the die holder. So you would take your old die holder off the machine and replace it with either a hand crank version or a CNC controlled version. CNC controlled would requires cooperation with the press brake builder to have the drives or the like to run that. So probably 99% of the time, people adding that to their existing machines are buying the hand crank version. And as I mentioned, the hand crank version does have a dial indicator on it, so you do know how far you've moved and where you're at, so you can get back to the same place. You can either get back to zero between jobs, or you can look at your setup sheet where you've referenced and written the number down and turn the crank till you get back to the right place. All right. So my recommendation, though, if you're going down this road, is to really consider the condition of your machine and of your tooling before you put this on. If you expect these devices to be foolproof and to fix all your forming woes, you might be disappointed. So what I mean by that is, if you have some serious damage to your bed or ram, first thing to do is just to run your finger across the ram nose of the machine. And if you can feel indentions there, you know you've had a lot of overload over the years that have caused that damage. You might want to consider some outfits that can do some local milling to dress that up. There are companies out there who can bring a portable mill and clean that up, dress that up for you. So that would be something that you would want to consider, because even though these die holder based mechanical wedge systems do have some localized adjustments, they have some push-pull screws maybe on every 8 or 10 inches where you can make some adjustments for some of that damage. It's really a tough trial and error way to get your machine bed and ram set back parallel again. So that's my first recommendation. And then the second is also with the press brake tooling that you're putting in. If you know, expecting these devices to help compensate for worn tools is a challenge. They're really designed to compensate for the deflection of the machine, not for wear and tear in the tools. So if you use segmented tools, for example, and you've got a set, let's say you've got a length of segmented tool that's maybe 18 or 20 inches long, and you use that die over and over and over, and now you add other pieces to the ends of that to get you into the 10 foot, and now you're needing to have some deflection compensation. If that tool is really worn, you might not have enough adjustment to compensate for that. So although I think these mechanical wedge systems are great and will really help your productivity adding to an existing machine, just kind of step back and look at the condition of your machine first. It's like putting a brand new set of tires on your old car and expecting that to solve all of your suspension problems. That may not be the complete answer here for you. But these are very popular retrofit. They offer a lot of productivity, a lot of time savings. And based on that polling question, a lot of you could benefit from adding something like this to your machine. So with that, I think I just have one more quick topic that I get asked a lot is, well, what type of preventative maintenance, or you know, what's involved with these different systems from a maintenance perspective? And my answer there is both of these types of systems, there are areas where some lubrication is necessary. On the hydraulic crowning cylinder shown on the left, those deflection pins have some grease fittings. There are seals in the like in the cylinder piston area there that could wear out and could leak over time, talking over many years of use. that might need to have, be replaced. The wedge system also has some requirements. So if you can imagine how much force is generated on those wedge areas, there on the upper right picture, there's also some grease and lubrication that goes on in there. I think the manufacturers of these devices would recommend, I don't know if it's exactly, around a year, to take those apart, re-grease them, put them back together to make sure everything's moving and not hanging up and binding because of some old grease or lack of lubrication. So with a little bit of care, either of these systems will last you years and years and give you great results for years of use on your press brake. So that kind of brings me to my conclusion here and kind of back to, the whole fishing analogy. Hopefully this will help you be more successful at your craft. And catching fish is the hard part of fishing. Making good parts is the hard part of bending, but encourage you can do it. And having a better understanding of what's going on the longer parts, I think will lead you to those goals. So that is really the end here for me, Nikki.
Okay.
You've got some questions or comments or anything that you want to talk about before we wrap things up? I think we're doing okay time-wise, so.
Yes, we've got a couple minutes. I was able to pull about 3 questions out, so I'm hoping we can get that before they kick us off.
Okay.
So, all right. So the first one is, can I use crowning system to fix worn tooling? I think you recently covered this.
Yeah, I just kind of covered that one again. Since someone asked that question, the expectation of the crowning device, really the purpose, is not to correct your worn tooling issues. It's to compensate for the deflection of the machine. So although I'm not saying people don't use it for that reason, I wouldn't rely on that. You really should consider the condition of your tools. And if you're going to spend the money to add a retrofit crowning system, I would also budget some monies to get you some good quality tools at the same time.
Okay. All right. Then the next question, let's see, which length systems are available for retrofit? Kind of
okay.
Like a part 2.
Yeah. Good question there. So, think back to what I talked about. There was a chart that I showed where in a lot of cases, if the part is really shorter than 4 feet, you may not have that much of an issue. So usually these crowning systems come into play on machines for really machines that are maybe 6 feet or longer. They can be put on machines a lot longer than that you might imagine. I know the mechanical wedge crowning units are not uncommon, up to 20 foot long machines. Crowning cylinders as well can be done on machines of that length. Many times you get in that length, we may use 2 cylinders instead of a single cylinder. Can you just imagine how much displacement we need to create? And 2 cylinders might give us a better distribution over a long bed to do that. So, yeah, I mean, we're pretty well covered in the mainstream length of machines to 20 feet, although I have seen systems, believe it or not, as long as 40 feet as a custom design product. So don't let the length discourage you from asking.
Nice. Well, then the third question comes more about those custom. Is that what about machines larger than the 500 ton?
Yeah. The biggest thing there typically is you need to pay attention. Again, we're talking retrofit system, which would be the die holder version, mechanical wedge. The only thing there to keep in mind is oftentimes on the big long machines, big heavy tonnage, you're dealing with pretty big V openings. So you need to be asking about the width of these wedge die holders. You know, the normal size are about 3.5 inches wide. You can go as wide as 10 inches wide, and then maybe a custom system that's even wider than that. So, if you're doing 3/4 inch material and you might have an 8 inch V opening, good rule of thumb is to have die support underneath at least the width of that V. So, They're available on big machines, various die holder widths and lengths.
Gotcha. Well, I know we're pushing past our 1 hour limit here, so I think we're going to go ahead and wrap this up. And I know we didn't get to, I know you guys are asking some beautiful, beautiful questions. I know we didn't get to them all, but we have recorded them and we're going to answer them, I promise. But for right now, I think we're probably good just to wrap this up and wish everybody a great weekend and hope the weather's nice where y'all are.
Sounds good. Thank you, Nikki, for helping out here.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much, Todd. You take care.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for attending.